Hello everyone, today I'm interviewing Mark Sherry, a very talented producer who is considered a pioneer of the Tech-trance scene. How are you, Mark?
Hi Sam, I'm good, thanks. How are you?
Very good. Thank you for coming on.
Yeah, no problem at all. Nice to be asked.
So, let's start right at the start. How did you initially get into music production?
I've kind of got my mum and dad to thank for that. They bought me a really dodgy Yamaha keyboard when I was like 7 years old, and I used to sit with these massive big old fashioned headphones on and like play along to all the TV theme tunes and all that kind of stuff. So I kind of picked up music. It seemed to happen quite easily for me back in the day, and then my mum and dad also they kind of started me on basic piano lessons, and I kind of worked my way up through the piano books. And then one day I went into my piano tutor's room, and she'd bought this, like, it was basically this massive fancy keyboard sitting in the corner of the room, and all of a sudden, I just completely lost interest in the piano, and I was wanting to go over to this keyboard and press all the buttons. And because of all the flashing lights, it just kind of, I was like a moth to a flame. It just pulled me in, and I kind of got the taste for electronic sounds at a very young age. And then, so obviously, I gave up the piano lessons, and I kept on going to the lessons, but it was kind of primarily keyboard lessons after that. And I went to lessons for about 6 or 7 years. Cut a long story short, after that, I kind of fell away from music for a few years. I kind of discovered the DJing, and I was getting into buying vinyl and stuff. And then I bumped into a DJ that I knew locally, a guy called Trevor Riley. And he basically told me that he'd basically bought a new studio in Glasgow, and he knew that I'd played the keyboards, and he asked me up one day just to have a kind of more or less a jamming session. And we clicked off right from the start, and we basically formed I can laugh at it now, but we basically formed a happy hardcore band, and we started making like 165 BPM absolute chaos.
Yeah.
And then just, one thing led to another, and here's me 20 years later.
Awesome. So do you think those keyboard lessons, piano lessons, helped later on with production?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I'm not like a musical genius. There's like so many more producers out there that are much more talented than me when it comes to writing music and, knowing their music theory and all that kind of stuff. But without sounding arrogant, I'd like to think that I know what sounds good and, what chords work with each other. And when I'm writing melodies and writing chords and, doing all the kind of basic stuff, I know that I'm quite good at knowing when I'm doing something right. I'm not a musical genius, as I said, but I think I'm quite good at, making catchy melodies and catching the right kind of, vibes and chords within a track to give it either like a kind of sinister feel or an uplifting feel. I think I know the basics well enough to really help with the kind of style of music that I'm making at the time.
Right, for sure. And what about DJing then? Because I know that a lot of people start out as DJs and they find that getting into production is, a lot easier compared to someone who's not musical at all getting into production, because they understand phrasing, they understand structure, energy and so on. Do you think that played a part?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, I mean, it's not like back when I first started DJing, you get booked to like play as a DJ if you're a good DJ. Whereas nowadays, you get booked to DJ if you've got a big track out. So I mean, it is really important to have both. I feel that I'm lucky that I was doing both at the same time. They were both like kind of running parallel with each other. I do actually feel really sorry for guys that are good producers but can't mix cake mix, it's like because they're making all these really good tracks, and then all of a sudden they break into the scene, and then they're starting to get booked for DJing gigs, and they turn up and they really don't know how to DJ, and it's not a nice thing to see. I've seen it with a few people. But I think, just going back to the last topic, I think it does really help to have some sort of knowledge with music. I think any DJs that are listening to this just now who aren't producers, then I can't emphasize enough how much you have to try and get into production these days, because it's not enough just to be a good DJ, in my opinion. There are a few DJs out there. I mean, even take Eddie Halliwell, for instance. Eddie's like, in my eyes, one of the most talented DJs the dance scene's ever seen. And it's only within the last few years where he's kind of upped his game and thought, maybe I should actually start making some music here. And that's why he has been you know, releasing some stuff. But I think it's so important that you have to do both these days. It's not enough. And vice versa, if you're a producer and you're starting to get booked for DJing, then you need to get your headphones on and start learning to mix, because you're just going to make a complete fool of yourself if you don't. You know, these days it's just one bad gig is enough to ruin your career, especially with everybody and their dog recording you on their iPhones and, you know, videos and the gigs and stuff. There's so many car crash mixes on YouTube and stuff, so you have to be really careful that you're doing things well, you know, to the kind of best of your ability.
Yeah, I totally agree. And I think the DJs that aren't producers who do make it, it's almost an exception to the rule, I think, these days. If that makes sense.
Yeah. Yeah, of course, yeah.
Mm. Okay, so one thing that stands out in all your tracks is your incredibly clean and tight low end. What advice would you give to producers struggling to mix their low end?
I think it's a combination of just using the right enhancers to get the low end right. And also, I mean, I use we'll probably go into this later on in the interview, but I absolutely love the multiband compressor that comes with Cubase. And it's, you know, it's a really simple plugin. It's really easy to use, but it really, really helps me tighten up the lower end of my tracks. You can also use things like R-Bass, which is really good, but you have to be, one problem I have noticed a lot of people, the kind of mistake a lot of people make with R-Bass is it can be so overpowering very, very easily. Mm. You've got to pull things very back a lot to get a good sound out of it, because it's so easy to go crazy with it and you end up just eating up all your headroom with sub bass, you know, and that's not good unless you want that big kind of real rumbly over bass, you know, bassy kind of techno kind of stuff or something. But it's something that I use in quite a lot of my especially at the mastering stage, but I also use it within my tracks as well. And it's a case of layering the right bass sounds as well. You know, I've always usually got maybe three basses, sometimes there's four basses. I've always got one kind of, maybe like a, you know, a sine kind of style bass doing the subs. I've got, you know, maybe a couple of mids and one kind of top end bass. Like it's like a bass sound, but it's got the low end cut off of it. So I'm basically making like a big kind of bass, it's like a bass sandwich, if you like, you know.
Right,
it's just a case of getting the right layers right and making sure that none of your bass sounds are phasing with each other. And that really kind of helps you tighten things up. And obviously EQing as well is very, very important. You know, if you've got two sounds that are slightly clashing with each other, just make sure the sub frequencies, the bass frequencies, there's nothing clashing in there at all. You have to make it as tight as you can. And obviously, the multiband compressor helps, and just using normal compression as well, you know, just getting everything nice and tight in there.
Totally. Awesome. So you mentioned you use Cubase. What do you like about Cubase specifically, and have you experimented with other workstations?
Yeah, I mean, again, going back to what I'd said earlier, the guy, Trevor Riley, that I started working with at a very young age, he used Cubase 5. Now, I don't mean the recent Cubase 5. I'm talking about a way back in the day with Cubase 5 was like prehistoric. And it's something that I've been brought up with, you know, with using Cubase, and it's something that I've really stuck by. I mean, I worked with like guys like Matt Dairy and BK and Nick Sentience. I've had the pleasure of working with them a few years ago, around about 2004, 2005. And they were all using Logic. And, you know, I enjoyed working with them and using Logic and stuff, but I'd heard so many people saying, oh, Logic's the best, you know, oh, it's so good compared to Cubase, blah, blah, blah. And when I saw the guys working on it, I was like, well, yeah, it seems okay, but there's nothing really here to tempt me over from Cubase. So it's something that I've stuck by. And recently, just within the last few weeks, I've updated to Cubase version 7.5. And it's a beautiful DAW, man. It's so easy to use. It looks great, very functional. You know, it's got so many shortcuts and things you can do. It's just amazing. It makes your studio sessions just like so much more enjoyable.
Absolutely. Do you think? Because I've heard that new producers complain about it being a bit too overwhelming. Would you agree with that or not?
I wouldn't say it's any more overwhelming than anything else. You know, I think these days, I don't think there's as much difference between each DAW. You know, we've obviously got like, you know, FL Studio and Logic and Cubase and Ableton. They're all roughly doing the same thing. It just depends on what you like and what you've been shown to use, or what you've, you know, what tutorials you've watched or whoever you've worked with. But I think one thing with Cubase, and I think this goes for all DAWs, and I've said this in a few interviews, I think it's very important when you're learning to write music. It's so boring just watching tutorials or picking up, you know, like manuals and teaching yourself how to do things. Get yourself into a studio and work with somebody and watch them doing it. There must be people who live locally, somebody who lives near you on in a city near you or something that wouldn't mind you maybe sitting in with them for a day or two, or even doing a collab together, or even just sitting in with them and sitting in the background, sitting having a coffee and just watching somebody work.
Right.
You learn so much faster by watching somebody else work. And so I don't think it matters these days. You know, okay, I'm a diehard Cubase fan, but I don't think these days it matters what DAW you're using. I think it just depends on you know, how you learn how to do it. And the most important thing is that you enjoy it, because if you don't enjoy it, it's not going to work for you. You have to be prepared to do very long hours in the studio. And if you're not enjoying yourself in it, it's game over. You'll just lose interest very, very fast.
Sure. I see, just following on from that, I see a lot of producers, new ones especially, you know, they hop around from door to door for some reason because they think it's going to help them make better music. And I totally agree with you. It's about putting in the hours and,
yeah,
you know, at the end of the day, they're mostly the same. You can get similar results from the, you know, different programs.
Yeah, that's it.
Okay, so your use of tension and energy is, you know, incredibly good. Your tracks, they go off on the dance floor. Without giving away too many secrets, do you have any tips or tricks for adding a bit of extra tension to tracks?
I think that's all down to using your effects well. You know, it's okay having a big killer lead and a break and a big, you know, killer string breakdown or something, but at the end of the day, you have to get out of that somehow. And I think that sometimes can be the part that I spend the longest on. I mean, I spend a lot of time in my kick drum and my basses and the percussion, and especially the groove. The groove in a track always takes me quite a long time. I'm a bit anal when it comes to percussion and grooves, to be honest. But one of the most important parts in the track is getting out of that breakdown and doing it in a clever way. I mean, to kind of give away, not really give away too much, but to give away some of my secrets, I find that using like a tape delay or feedback delay or a reverb crescendo build up or something, you know, where you've maybe got like a small stab sound or a small lead sound, which you kind of build up over the space of maybe 8 bars or 16 bars just by going from having like a dry reverb mix going into a wet mix, so that it's gradually kind of getting louder and louder and louder, building up. And then as you're doing that, you can like high pass the frequencies as well, so that the reverb tail is gradually getting high passed with a filter. Or you can use like the tape delays, like an old classic that I've used, I think, in every single production I've ever done, is it's a free plugin called Bionic Delay. It's like a little orange delay.
Yeah,
and
love that
plugin. You know, it's amazing. It's just, you know, it's like what Sander Van Doorn used as well. I think there's a delay that comes with Logic. I don't know if it's still in Logic. But you know, there's a delay, a kind of tape delay that he used to use in all his old tracks, and it just gives you that big kind of moment of madness, because the frequencies just start to repeat over themselves with the tape delay, and the whole track just starts to go crazy because of these the frequencies that are getting louder. And you know, just it adds so much more tension. So a combination of doing that, you can also do, you know, using a lot more of the parameters in your plugins, like, you know, with Silent or Massive, you can adjust the release, you know, using the release and using different, like, using your LFOs to get the sound going crazy and stuff. You can use pitch bending. There's so many different ways. I think, you know, you just have to get creative. If it means sitting all day or sitting for 2 days just on that part of the track, it's worth it, because that's the part that makes the people go nuts on the dance floor. If you don't have that tension, then it's not going to work. You're just going to get people looking at you playing with their phones while they're on the dance floor. It's not going to work. I mean, I've had quite a few guys doing remixes for me just over the last few weeks. I mean, obviously we'll speak about this later with the new record labels, but there's a few guys they've submitted really good remixes, but there's just not been enough tension in the build-ups, and I've had to kind of go back and forth with them, you know, send a few kind of detailed emails and say, look, I love the track, but can you please try this? Can you please try that? And it's usually 9 times out of 10, it's the build-up that I'm not happy with, because it's such an important, integral part of any good dance track.
Absolutely. Do you think you're inspired by a lot of techno, as I understand?
Yep, absolutely.
Do you think that some of your techniques and so on come from techno? Because I listen to a lot of trance and just dance music in general, and the build-ups are very cliche and generic. And that's not a bad thing as long as they work. But listening to your tracks, you know, you've got all the stuff going on, all these different ideas and very unique build-ups. So would you say that comes from maybe techno or...?
Yeah, and I'd say so. I mean, the whole kind of vibe with Tech-trance is, for me, the main difference with Tech-trance and normal trance is the percussion. You know, I like to have a nice, I like to have a big rumble in my tracks, which a lot of the trance, it's too clean and too, you know, clinical. And okay, I do like a, I like a clean sound and I like a relatively clinical sound, but sometimes with my own Tech-trance, I like to leave things a little bit rough just to give you that, the bottom end rumble and the kind of noisiness and stuff, just the kind of the rawness, which a lot of people seem to EQ out, you know. And I do spend a lot of time doing my EQing and making sure there's nothing clashing or, you know, things are getting, any frequencies are getting eaten up that shouldn't be getting eaten up. But at the end of the day, I do like to have quite a kind of rough sound. And I do believe that that comes from having big influences from techno just over the years. You know, listen to guys, I mention them in every single interview, guys like Mauro Picotto, and you know, obviously it's not just him that was involved in the studio. It's like his studio engineer, Ricardo Ferri, or Ricky F, as he gets called. Him and Mauro, just as a team, they're, you know, absolute geniuses. And some of the techno that they were releasing on their BXR label back in the day, it was just such a breath of fresh air for me in the studio, and it just really tried to encourage me to try and bend the rule book and just, you know, rip up the rule book really and just throw it out the window and try and different techniques and getting a real kind of techno-y sound. I mean, I suppose recently I've tried to reinvent Tech-trance a little bit, but over the next few months I'm actually going to go probably full circle and really get, you know, try and get back into doing some proper real kind of techno, kind of Tech-trance, still Tech-trance, but a lot more techno orientated. So that'll be quite an interesting few months, I think.
Well, I'm looking forward to that.
Thanks, man.
So how do you normally start a track? Do you start with the drums or a melody, or does it change every time?
Always the drums. I mean, you get guys who I think will start with like a melody, or, you know, choosing their sounds and stuff. I think this is a quite an important tip which I always give to people. Even before you start a track, before you, like, I always start with the kick drum and the bass line and the percussion. Sometimes usually just the kick and the percussion, then the bass line kind of comes into it. But I think one big tip I think to give people would be is to say that you have to prepare for a track before you start it. I think it's good to, you know, like, open a new folder, go through some, you know, get some drum loops, get some samples, get some kick drums. Think about layering some kick drums. Don't just pick one kick that you like. Maybe pick like a kind of 808 kick or a 909 kick and think about, like, you know, trying to find another track that will sit on top of that as your main kick, and then try and find another little sound or something that you can add on top of that kick. So, and try and find some good, maybe some vocal samples or some stabs or some interesting little quirky, no, random things. So try and get a folder, first of all. Chuck as many ideas and as many samples into that folder as you can, and I guarantee you your track will come together a lot faster than it would if you just kind of start a track from scratch. So that would be the first advice that I give people. And then secondly is just, obviously, I always start my tracks with the kick drums, getting, you know, two or three kick drums layered, and then I'll move into, like, you know, just like closed hats, open hats, rides, claps, little drum loops, little fills and stuff, and then I'll maybe like a bass line will come into my head as I'm actually preparing the groove of the track. Whether it's, you know, you can sometimes add in like 909 tom drums or other kind of distorted toms, muck around with those first of all, and see, like, sometimes a groove just happens with the drums, and you can fit your bass MIDI notes around that groove and take it from there. Sometimes it happens really quickly, sometimes it takes like a day for you to get a good groove, but, you know, everybody's different, but that's the way that I've always worked. It just seems to kind of work best for me. And then once I'm up and running with that kind of 8-bar loop, then I'll start to add in maybe some, you know, arpeggios or little chords and stuff, and try and build up a track just basically from the ground up. And then, you know, you'll keep on just working away at it, and you'll get to the breakdown. Then that's when I'm up to the breakdown, I'll probably have a rough idea of where the track's going to go at that point, whether it's going to be a, you know, like a kind of techno builder, or whether it's going to go into like a full-blown hands in the air riff, or, you know, sort of kind of string breakdown and stuff. But that's usually how I start things.
Right, definitely. Do you use a template, like a starter template by any chance with all your audio channels set up, or is it a blank canvas for you?
It's almost a blank canvas. I sometimes use a track that I've just finished if things are going well, and I think everybody's the same. I don't think it matters what DAW you use, but sometimes you have a bad session, whereas, you know, well, maybe things will, it's like if you're writing a track, sometimes things get a little bit glitchy and you're not too sure why it's getting glitchy, but then so sometimes if that happens and you get the track finished, it's better to start your next track with a clean template. But sometimes if I'm on a roll, or if I've got like a few deadlines to meet and things are quite tight, then I'll just use a template. But obviously I'm changing everything in that template, but just to give me the general structure, I'll just use a template that I've used recently just to kind of get me up and running. Sometimes I'll use the same kick drum just until I find, you know, get a good groove, get some ideas, and then I'll start to go back and I'll work back the way, and I'll start to, you know, preview new kick drums and try and get, just so that each track's different. I don't like using the same kick or samples and like, you know, each track kind of thing. I like to have a completely fresh sound.
Absolutely. Okay, so you run a mastering service too.
Yep.
I'm sure a lot of people would like to know, you know, what software you use for mastering. You don't need to give away too many secrets.
Yeah, it's okay. I can tell you a few things I use. Obviously, I've mentioned that I use the multiband compressor because I know it like the back of my hand. I find it a really, really good, easy to use plugin within Cubase, and it just gives you a really nice sound. You can, you know, really kind of zone in the frequencies, like if there's any troublesome frequencies in the bass end and the mids and the tops, and it gives you, you can actually, you know, EQ, which what I like about the multiband that comes with the Cubase, you can use it to EQ certain things as well. So that's really good. One of the kind of most recent additions to my studio, which I've noticed a lot of guys have been talking about online as well, is the Fab Filter Pro Q2. It's just an absolutely brilliant, it's so easy to use, it's a brilliant EQ, and one of the best things about it is you can blow it up into full screen, which is good for guys like myself for getting on a bit and starting to lose their eyesight. So it saves me wearing my glasses in the studio. But I find that's a great EQ. I also use the URS suites. There's a URS guys make a compressor suite, and they also make an EQ suite. There's like the N12 EQ, which is a great EQ, and it's just, you know, you get a really, really nice sound. It's a very, very, very powerful EQ. You don't need to tweak it much at all. So it's really easy to use. And also, like, stuff like the AOM stuff's good to use, Invisible Limiter. They've got a stereo imaging as well. And, you know, stuff like, I still use, occasionally, it depends, every single mastering job is different. You know, I can't sit here and say I've got an exact formula for every mastering job that I do. Every single track that's like a completely fresh palette. I've got my own kind of techniques that I use for each job. And I've got, you know, there's multiple different EQs and compressors and multiband compressors and stereo imagers and limiters and stuff that I'll use for each track. It just depends on what the track's lacking or what it needs taken out or what it needs added. You know, everything is different. But that's just to give you an idea of some of the stuff that I use.
Oh, awesome. So for the producers listening, if they want to use your mastering service, how would they take advantage of that?
Well, you can contact me at mastering@marksherry.net. That's my main, that is the only email address for the mastering. And I'll always get back to you within, you know, if you email me in the morning, you'll have a reply on the same day, usually within 30 minutes or an hour. I'm always good with the emails. I'm very kind of switched on when it comes to that kind of stuff. And I can, 99% of the time, I can always guarantee a 24-hour return service as well. So if you get the track into me, I'll make a point of saying this, I don't actually have internet in the studio, and that's deliberate because I don't want to sit on Facebook or be checking my emails all day in the studio. I just do that on my phone when I have to. So if you need a track mastered, if you get them into me by like 11 o'clock in the morning any day, you'll have it back on the same day, usually like before 7 p.m. at night time. Wow. If not, feeling that, you'll have it back the day after. But all of this obviously depends on where I am in the world. If I'm on a tour or away for a few days or away for a long weekend, then you know, there's sometimes a delay, but 99% of the time I'm usually able to return any mastering jobs within 24 hours.
That's extremely quick.
Yeah, it's not too bad.
Cool. So let's talk about your record label, Outburst Records, and also the much recent addition, Techburst Records. What was your reasoning behind them?
Well, you know, it's just there's so many guys now have got their own record labels, and it's something that I've always wanted to do. I've wanted to do it probably for like the last 10 years. I think without going into it too much, because I'll end up getting depressed, but honestly, man, I've had so much bad luck with record labels in the past. Just with doing the commercial stuff with Public Domain, and with a lot of bad luck in the past, and dealing with some of the record label guys that you have to deal with, I'm surprised I'm still alive, to be honest. Some of the stress they put you under is ridiculous. Mm. Back in the day, so obviously it's not been the same recently because I've not been like doing commercial stuff. But again, that was something I didn't really mean to do. I didn't mean to end up ever doing commercial dance music, but it was something that happened and we rolled with it. Mm. But just being able to do my own record label now and not have to deal with, you know, some of the idiots that come with the dance industry on the kind of bigger scale, it's just absolute bliss. Mm-hmm. And I've always kind of thought of myself as being quite good at doing A&R and trying to get the best out of people. And there's been a lot of people have submitted like really, really good demos to the label, and I've spent time with them and I've gone back and forth in emails, and I've really helped them make the tracks a lot better. And it's something that I've always wanted to do. It's something I've always thought I'd be good at doing. And it's brilliant to have that freedom now. And obviously the mastering jobs actually that alone has actually introduced me to so many really talented producers that I've now signed to the label. And I've got them doing remixes for me, and I've got them doing original tracks for me. There's so many people that are willing to help me try and bring back the Tech-trance sound. There's guys that are, you know, known for doing like 140 trance, or known for doing techno, or known for doing uplifting stuff, who are all submitting these Tech-trance demos to me. I'm like, Jesus, man, the tracks are so good, and they've totally embraced what I'm trying to do with the label and trying to bring back that old Tech-trance sound that seems to have, I mean, it hasn't vanished for me. I've always tried to keep my sets techie, and I have always tried to kind of keep the Tech-trance track, the flag flying, sorry. So it's been really good to meet these people and get them all on board. And I feel very, very lucky to have this amazing group of people working with me just now on the label. And that's obviously for Outburst. And then just as a kind of sideline, I've been getting a lot of good techno demos as well. And I think this would be a good time to start a techno sister label as well. And that's why I've started Techburst. And I've got, you know, got some really good stuff lined up on that as well. But that's going to be like a really kind of dark, like 100% techno label. There's not going to be any trance on there at all. So it's good to have both labels kind of running alongside each other.
Cool. So on Outburst, what kind of releases have you got coming up? Anything we should know about?
Yeah, I mean, well, so far it's got off to a really great start. I had like John O'Callaghan did a joint operations center remix of my old track, Live and Learn, that I released in Detox 10 years ago. So that was quite kind of fitting to re-release the track on my own label this time. And Alex DiStefano, who's for me is like one of the most exciting producers out there just now.
Definitely.
He doesn't know how good he is. He's got absolutely no idea how good he is. So to have those guys on the label is just, you know, off to a great start. And I've got so much respect for John O'Callaghan as well. And then I had my second release was just out 3 weeks ago, and it was a collab with Claire Stagg, who's an amazing folk singer. She's done some really cool stuff with Solarstone, and it was actually Rich from Solarstone that introduced me to her. So that was the second release. The third release comes out a week. It comes out on Monday now, and it's an EP from a Russian guy called Amun, who usually does progressive stuff, but he kind of likes the sound that I've got. And he actually contacted me again. He kind of contacted me just an email and said, look, I'd really like to do some Tech-trance for you. Can you give me an idea of what kind of stuff you're looking for? So just I mentioned Marcel Woods to him, and he's come back and he's delivered like two absolutely amazing kind of Marcel Woods style tracks. One's called Mental Universe, another one's called Soul Fire. So they come out on Monday. And then I've got an EP from Alex DiStefano coming up as well, which is, for me, it's like some of the best stuff he's ever produced.
Is that the two tracks up on SoundCloud at the moment?
Yes, mate. Yeah. Escape from the Past and Dark Purple.
Oh, they're awesome.
He's amazing. He's absolutely amazing. And again, I kind of spoke to him. I had a good few kind of A&R emails back and forth with him. And I'd said to Alex, I said, look, you know, I absolutely love your techno sound, but how do you feel about, you know, trying to incorporate some trance into your tracks, just, or even one of the tracks for the EP? And he said, yeah, of course. And he's always actually, he's been a massive fan of Mikey, you know, from Push. from back in the day, and he's come up with this riff in Escape from the Past, which is just it's incredible. And he's actually done a follow up to that as well, which isn't going to be released until next year. And again, it's just that big angry techno track, but it's got like a massive lush kind of trance breakdown. And he's done a techno release for me as well for Techburst. So he's been a big asset to the labels already.
I can imagine.
Yeah, so I've been digging out some of my older tracks as well, like Here Come the Drums that I did with Dr. Willis back in, actually recorded that in Melbourne back in 2005, I think it was. So I'm now re-releasing that on my own label with Sean Tyus has done a mix as well, which is amazing, and Harmonic Rush, he's done a mix. So that they're both coming out on Outburst, and I've also got techno remixes of it coming up on Techburst. The same with my old track Vengeance as well. There's trance mixes and techno mixes coming to that, and I've also got some new singles, and I'm going to start doing like an EP on Outburst Records as well called the Bursting Out EP. So it'll be like Bursting Out Volume 1, Volume 2, blah blah blah, and it's like a 4-track EP, and they're all going to be like tech trance releases. And I've got guys like Second Sign, and there's a guy called Gordon Bates, there's Chris Morton from Canada. And there's a few other guys. I've got guys, the Second Phase guys from Glasgow. They've done a lot of stuff for me as well. So it's really exciting for me to have all this stuff coming up. So it's kind of really, really, really exciting times for me. So I just hope it all goes well.
Definitely. And for those listening that don't know, you also have a radio show called, is it Outburst?
Yep, it's Outburst. Outburst Radio Show. Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah, it goes out on After Hours FM every Friday night at 10 o'clock until 11. It's just basically an hour of trance, tech trance and techno. There's a techno section at the end now called the Techburst Selection, which obviously kind of ties in with the record label. And you can get it on SoundCloud. It's on iTunes as a podcast, downloadable podcast, and it's like syndicated to 20 other radio stations as well, like DI.FM and all the kind of main ones. So that's a weekly podcast.
Awesome. Fantastic. Okay, we'll have one more question before we head into the quick fire questions.
Okay.
How do you see Tech-trance changing over the next 5 to 10 years?
Well, I'd like to think it's still going to be here. I mean, it's 10 years down the line and it's still here. You've got guys like Mauro Picotto and Marco V and Marcel Woods and, Randy Catana, all these guys back in the day that kind of more or less kind of started the scene for me before I'd even got into Tech-trance. So I've got a lot to thank these guys for just inspiring me to kind of kick the whole thing off. So, 10 years, it's probably about 14 years down the line, almost 15 years down the line. So hopefully it will still, I'm pretty sure it still will be. If I've got anything to do with it, it will still be here. I'd like to think it's going to be pretty much similar to what it is just now. I think if it was to change too much, then it's obviously not going to be tech trance anymore. I don't want it to slow down and become like EDM car crash kind of genre. I'd like it to try definitely. I'd like it to stay underground and stick to its roots. Obviously the sounds are going to change, the techniques are going to change, but I think the fundamental sound of tech trance is it's going to be the same, or else there's only so much you can really change something before it turns into something else. So I think you've got your diehard tech trance fans that will stick with the genre and keep it as popular as it is, and it's definitely making a big comeback just now, so it's quite good to see.
Cool. Okay, we'll get onto these quick fire questions.
Okay.
So, to start with, what's your favourite synth plugin? Just one.
Oh man. right. Okay. I'm gonna say something different this time. I'm gonna say Spire. I usually say Massive and Silence, but I've used them to death, and I'm really enjoying working with Spire just now. I think it's an amazing synth, and some of the sounds you get out of it is absolutely fantastic. And I've got to give a mention to David and the Freshly Squeezed crew. The sounds they're giving it, well, not giving away, but the sounds that they're putting out just now for the synths are amazing, and the Spire banks are fantastic. I've been using them a lot in my productions recently.
They are good banks. Do you have any particular one that's a favourite of yours?
Not off the top of my head. They're all really good just now. There's not really one kind of go-to one just now. I kind of flick between a few of them. I'm trying to remember the names of the ones that I'm using. I think it's the Essential Collection or something. There's like, yeah, volume one and two.
Temple One. Spires.
And the
Sunny Licks one. Have you got that yet?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, it's Tempo One and Sunny Licks. You know that you're just going to get quality, and it's not just with Spire, with you know Silenth and the Massive as well. They've got really, really good stuff going on. It's a good time for sound banks.
Yeah, appreciate the plug.
No worries.
Okay, favorite effect plugin.
Well, the one I've used the most is Bionic Delay. I've used that in almost every track, I think, you know, since I started producing all the kind of Tech-trance stuff. Okay, I'm going to say something different. I'm going to say Warm Verb. It's a brilliant reverb unit. In fact, it's not just reverb, it's a multi-effects plugin, and it's got delays, it's got reverbs, it's got phasers, flangers, everything. It's just a really good kind of multi-purpose effect, and it's good for just bringing some life to your, you know, especially the reverbs are massive. There's a trance reverb which is just ridiculous, and I've used it in a lot of tracks. You can turn like a tiny little shitty sound into a really massive sound just at the click of a button, you know. So it's a really, really good a good plugin to have on your system.
Awesome. Okay, I'm going to put you on the spot once again. If you had to listen to one artist on repeat for 24 hours, who would it be?
Mauro Picotto.
Yep.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Good choice. Okay.
Enough said.
Yep. Okay, one last question. What's one thing you wish you knew when starting out producing?
When I started? I wished that I had more courage to learn about it more. I was it sounds strange, but I was scared of technology at that time, you know. I was very it was quite a daunting experience. I remember going into the studio in Glasgow that I told you about, and I'm just like surrounded by all this equipment, and even though this overwhelming urge to learn about it and use it and, you know, start writing music, I was terrified of it at the same time. It was a very daunting thing. So I wish that I'd learned how to produce sooner than I did. It took me a few years to actually, in fact, it wasn't until 2004 that I actually started working completely on my own. I'd always worked with Trevor in Glasgow. I'd worked with, you know, some of the guys in Public Domain. James Allen I'd worked with. I still like work with him now sometimes. He's obviously in the room next to me at the studio that we share together.
Right, yeah.
And, you know, but when we were doing all the Public Domain stuff together, we're working as a team kind of thing. So, as I said, it wasn't until 2004 where I actually kind of grabbed the bull by the horns and learned how, no, not learned, I knew how to do it. But I wish, to cut a long story short, I wish that I'd started producing on my own a lot sooner than I did. I think it's not a big regret, but it's something that I do wish that I'd started a bit sooner. I should have been making music on my own a lot sooner than I did, considering the length of time that I've been in the scene for now. I mean, this is like my 20th year as a DJ this year.
Right,
so
yeah.
I've been celebrating all year, which has been really cool. But yeah, I do wish that I'd started working on my own sooner. It's something I should have done, but I suppose it was maybe just a part of me that was stupidly a bit scared. I was scared of making that leap of faith.
Right, that's a good answer for the people listening who aren't producing. Got to get onto it. All right, well, thank you for coming on.
Thanks a lot, Sam.
It's been a fantastic interview. And
thank you.
Take care, have a good one.
All right, cheers, buddy. See you soon.